Our next speaker is The Potential of Mineral Varieties for Forensic Soil Analysis. Andy Bowen works for a private forensic laboratory, Stony Forensics, in Chantilly, Virginia, where he's employed as a forensic scientist.
Thank you very much, Chris, and thank you to NIJ and FBI for the opportunity to speak here, especially an opportunity to talk about soil. Forensic soil analysis has become a strong personal interest of mine. I'll go through these first slides relatively quickly. You can read these when you get back home to keep us on schedule if possible. I was basically going to talk about the fact that soil evidence has been around for a long time, and despite that, only about a quarter of trace evidence labs in the U.S. currently do soil analysis, according to results of a survey reported here at this symposium 2 years ago. I think that has something to do with the variety of components and complexity of soil, along with the variety of published methods, as we heard at the talk earlier today by Gwyneth. Looking into what methods are used is a daunting task because of the great variety that's out there. And when I say why we should try to change this, what I'm suggesting we might want to change is the fact that only about a quarter of trace labs currently do soil in this country. There are some theoretical reasons why soil has a lot of potential as evidence. Its ubiquity, the great variety due to all the possible components and the various proportions with which they can be combined. Anyone with children, I've got a 3-year-old and 18-month-old. They might be watching right now for all I know. The ease with which they pick up soil and transfer it to everything in our house is evidence enough for me that it's got potential. And and if you go to the literature, Raymond Murray's book, Evidence in the Earth, has dozens and dozens of case examples, some of which pretty astonishing in terms of the value of the geologic evidence. John McPhee goes into greater detail in a smaller number of cases. And I think that, and I'm really talking about the United States here, I think the way to change this is to sort of get soil's foot in the door to more labs. And in order to do that, we need a method that largely uses the existing personnel and skills. Can't be, given the current fiscal situation, there's not a lot of opportunities to hire, loads and loads of geologists to start doing this. We also need to use existing equipment because most lab directors will tell you it's pretty hard to get funding for that kind of thing right now. And most importantly, the method needs to work. It has to take a reasonable amount of time. And I think if it gets in, so the method I'm proposing is not what I think would be the best method. I think the best method's probably already out there and we'll probably hear it two talks from now. I think Skip's going to go into some detail. But I think the gap between what currently exists and the kinds of things that Skip does or the FBI does, it's a large gap to bridge. And hopefully, if we can find something in between that allows people to start doing soil with their existing personnel and equipment, then sort of organically, I would imagine the methods would increase and people would get additional training and skills and hopefully start doing a more comprehensive soil analysis. And what I'm interested in talking about is the potential for mineral varieties, that the role they might play. The concept is basically that any given mineral has a range with respect to a number of its properties, morphological, inclusions, texture. We'll see examples of specific minerals in some of these properties. And they're analogous to class characteristics of fibers. So just like a fiber analyst doesn't stop by when they find nylon in two samples, they want to know what are the properties of the specific nylons in these cases and do they compare. The concept of mineral varieties has been used by geologists for over 100 years. The reference I run into when I read about this is typically a 1928 article by Alan Bramwell, where he sort of articulated this, I think, for the first time. And the early studies in the early mid-1900s, these mineral varieties were generally minerals that had the same properties grouped into a single varietal type. Most of it was done by optical microscopy and features you can observe with a PLM. The work is still done currently by sedimentary geologists, including some in this room. And now they tend to call it single grain studies as opposed to mineral variety studies. And they do more dating, radiometric dating, isotopic analysis, CL imaging, things that are more quantitative for comparative purposes. The reasons they do this are primarily so the image is not shown up quite as well up there, unfortunately. This is from that Bramwell article, and I've got copies of that and can tell you where to find it if you like. The idea is that If you're trying to figure out the source of detrital grains in a sediment or a sedimentary rock, you want to know if the sediment in this basin came from the granite that's on the, you know, up to the north, or the granite that outcrops to the south. They might both have similar minerals. They both have zircon. So the presence of these minerals in your sediment doesn't allow you to determine its source. But they notice that the variety, the zircon from one source might be colorless, zoned with particular inclusions. Another might be rounded, no zoning, clear, no inclusions. And so the varieties of these minerals could be used to associate the detrital grains with their sources. And the idea to use this in forensic science, comparing the varieties from a questioned soil to a known soil, it's not a new one. It's not my idea. I'd argue it's been around as long as forensic soil has been used in criminal cases. The first case that I know of, George Popp in 1908 in the Margaret Filbert case, if you read descriptions of that in various soils he's comparing to soil from the suspect's shoe, he describes the quartz in one sample as being splintery, in another sample as being milky. So clearly this appreciation for the qualities, properties of these minerals in addition to their identities was appreciated long ago. And 2007 in Heavy Minerals in Use, a chapter that Skip wrote, this quote jumped out at me. You know, they've come to place more than ordinary importance on this concept when they do their comparisons. And Skip is the one who brought this to my attention. So despite the fact that this has been around, I looking through the literature, I would argue there's really only been one systematic study that's been published that really sort of uses this concept. Now, that might change. There's some cathodoluminescence of feldspars that was talked about earlier, and I think that would probably fall into this category. The other exception is a study that focused on quartz grains, classifying them into different types based on their morphology and surface texture. And although it wasn't specifically called varietal types here, they were clearly using these properties to group these grains into different groups. Unfortunately, I don't know of many people in the U.S. doing this currently, and certainly within the crime lab setting, there are not too many people who have the type of expertise to start applying the SEM in this way. It might well be a better method than the one I'm proposing. I think that's a worthy debate to have. But what I think would be interesting would be to do some research looking at classifying minerals into varietal types using PLM and study perhaps 11 or 12 common minerals, look at several hundred soils from different locations, and go through and get a sense for how many varieties do we even find? How different are they from one location to another? How similar are they within a single location? The general types of things we're interested in whenever we look at a method and applying it to forensic soil analysis. So I think that would be really interesting, and that's sort of the research I'd like to see happen. Hopefully NIJ will fund me to do it. If not, if someone else does it, I think that would be great as well. The reason I think it has the possibility to sort of meet those admittedly arbitrary criteria I said at the beginning, it uses basically the same principles fiber analysis uses. You're identifying a small subset of materials. I imagine if we looked at 12 minerals, we'd find that five or so really show a lot of variety and would be most useful to focus on. And there might only be a relatively small subset of possible properties that helped us to group them into varieties. I don't know, but it's a hypothesis. And so I think the ultimate procedure might involve five or six minerals, all that someone needs to identify in a sample, and then characterizing them microscopically with skills they already have. It would use polarized light microscopes available in about 90% of trace evidence laboratories. The data comes from that same survey I mentioned earlier, presented 2 years ago at the symposium. And would it work? Research needs to answer that question. I think if it does work, the fact that we're focusing on a relatively small subset of the soil, just a single fine sand-sized mineral fraction would probably be all that would be looked at. Because you're not considering all the minerals in there required to identify all of them, that might speed up the analysis. We'll have to see exactly how much time that takes, but hopefully it would be efficient. And I think it would be effective in forensic scenarios for the same reasons sedimentary geologists use these. The sediment in a sedimentary basin is not going to be a one-to-one image of its source rock. There are a lot of things that happen from source to sediment that are going to change that assemblage. We've got differential weathering from the rock, differential transport based on shape, size, and density, differences of different minerals. We've got different minerals, different chemical stabilities. So some minerals are going to dissolve during diagenesis as the rock, sedimentary rock is formed or during transport. So there's all these possible things that can happen. Additional sediments can be mixed with it later, but the mineral varieties are still the same if they came from that source rock. I feel like forensic soil analysis runs into a lot of these same issues. We've got the potential for differential transfer persistence. I imagine that mica flakes, although I haven't seen evidence of this in literature, my hypothesis would be that mica flakes would adhere more readily to evidence and so as someone's walking around with mica on their shoes than around mineral like quartz or equant mineral like quartz. And I would imagine that a garnet and a quartz grain, that both having same shapes and same size, the garnet would be more likely to fall off being much more dense than the quartz would. So again, hypotheses, but I think there's some reason to suggest in the geologic literature that these kinds of fractionation and differential transfer and persistence are taking place, and certainly the possibility to contaminate a forensic soil sample with soil from another location is a very real one that we need to consider whenever as we think about methods to use for this particular application. So I'm going to just go through a few examples of commonly occurring minerals and the kinds of features that could be used. A lot of this comes from sedimentary geology literature. Sedimentary geologists are interested in looking at these properties of these minerals to help figure out what kinds of rocks they came from. Quartz from volcanic rocks is going to look different than quartz from a plutonic or certain types of metamorphic rocks. So you'll look at the grain morphology, something you get a lot more detail about, admittedly, by SEM, but you get some information by PLM. We've got polycrystallinity. Quartz can occur as single crystals. It can also occur as polycrystalline grains. The number of crystals in that polycrystalline grain, whether they're all the same size or different sizes, are all things that have been studied by sedimentary geologists to attribute source rocks to the sediments. The undulosity is a measure of the number of degrees over which extinction occurs in quartz, and that's something that can be used to distinguish quartz from one source and from quartz from another source. Inclusions, and then surface features. So we've got a rounded quartz grain at the top, a more angular one in the middle, and then a nice well-formed hexagonal bipyramid from it's a volcanic phenocryst at the bottom. So the morphology clearly varies quartz from source to source. We've got a nice single crystal at the top that showed complete extinction. You'll have to take my word for that. Polycrystalline grain in the middle, and then a grain showing undulose extinction at the bottom. These are some of the properties that vary that we can observe in quartz. Varieties of inclusions, both mineral inclusions, fluid inclusions, sometimes randomly oriented, sometimes aligned due to either processes that occurred during crystal growth or metamorphic episodes. Surface features, well, these aren't really surface features so much as we've got a rim of volcanic glass around the top grain. It's a little hard to see, but in the picture on the far right with the full wave plate, you might be able to make it up along the bottom of the grain. There's a volcanic glass rim, and the other grain there has some adhering iron oxide coatings. So that would be another potential feature to use. Different minerals are going to have different features or properties that are more useful for distinguishing among different varieties or classifying them into varietal types. Morphology is always going to be on the list, but with alkali feldspar, another extremely common mineral in sediments, we've got a variety of different twinning types, untwinned grains, simple twins, polysynthetic twinning or tartan twinning in microcline when you've got polysynthetic twinning along two separate laws. We've got exsolution when at high temperatures, sodium and potassium are happy to be mixed in, in with the high temperature crystal structure is happy to have sodium and potassium substitute for each other readily. And as you get to the lower temperature structure, in the lower temperature structure, the different sizes of these cations makes it such that they diffuse within the grain to different regions or domains within a crystal, and that process is called exsolution. It results in sodium-rich and potassium-rich regions within a single grain. That can only happen if the cooling is slow enough that diffusion can take place. The textures you get, these exsolution textures, vary significantly depending on the thermal history of those grains. Another difference between quartz is the alteration. Feldspar is much less chemically stable than quartz, so we have a lot more potential for weathering. And here we've got examples of different varieties, rounded, angular, nice well-formed euhedral crystal, tartan twinning, microcline at the top, simple twin, although it might be polysynthetic, but it's certainly coarser twinning. In the bottom, I believe we've got a combination of exsolution as well as twinning in our alkali feldspar example. Fluid inclusion from a volcanic feldspar on the upper left, we've got a a mineral inclusion at the upper right, and then this is lower one is almost certainly from a volcanic rock where we've got a foliation in the rutile that's been that's included in the alkali feldspar grain. Weathering from very fresh crystals at the top, highly weathered in the middle. The bottom one is also coated in a thin rim of volcanic glass. So just some more of the variety. Two more minerals, and then we'll wrap things up. Calcite, the biggest difference here, I think, is the tremendous range to morphological features you get, particularly with biogenic calcite sources. So we've got a nice cleavage rom at the top, an anhedral crystal, microcrystalline calcite, foraminifera, a shell fragment, I believe, although I'm not a micropaleontologist. And then we've got an ooid where the calcite's precipitated on a tiny grain. You know, by XRD, these are all calcite. So, but obviously, microscopically, the fact that we had calcite in two samples, if they look that different, should be significant to us. And then the last example I'm going to throw in here, tourmaline, simply because pleochroic scheme is something that can be particularly useful for describing varieties of particular minerals that exhibit pleochroism. And we have got tourmaline, three crystals that show, I think, a lot of different features, highly included, or a high number of inclusions in our nice euhedral tourmaline prism at the top that's sort of a brown to colorless. And we've got a very, very different pleochroic scheme, sort of a brownish green blue to a pink, and a very an anhedral poorly formed crystal, or no recognizable crystal faces in that middle crystal. And then we've got a nice prism that's a different pleochroic scheme from green to colorless in the bottom. There are going to be some interpretation-ish questions that need to be answered. If I find, one variety of quartz and a variety of feldspar in common between two samples, is that like finding a blue nylon and a red polyester from independent sources? And we've got to be careful about things like that because certain features or varieties are going to be more likely from particular volcanic types of rocks. So we might have these varieties similar because they're both from volcanic rocks as opposed to entirely different sources. I would imagine that different varieties of the same mineral coming from different rock sources and mixing would be pretty significant. Whether we can look at the proportions of the different mineral varieties is something I'm interested in. There was a caution in that article that I mentioned by Bowen Morgan that to make that claim requires certain assumptions that may not always be valid. So I'd be interested to see what the research indicates. But again, as it's been a theme throughout this meeting, we need the research before we can make these statements. So in summary, I'm proposing not a new concept, but a new approach to this concept, I believe. And I think that if we do this research, I think at best, it might be a method that could use existing personnel and skills with minimal training, existing equipment, and hopefully be robust to some of these differential transfer and persistent issues. I think at worst, it'll help the people who, like Skip, who are already using mineral varieties in sort of a less than quantitative way to assess the strength of evidence when they do have mineral varieties in common or different between samples. So this data, this type of research, I think, would be potentially of use to the community.